of his grace. Glory to God and praise and love he ever power good. By saints below and saints above, the church in heaven and suffered as if he did. And all authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every overcome. And we
Usually say the Lord's Prayer each week. It's a timeless way to share our spiritual connection both with God and with each other. And the Lord's Prayer was first given as a response when the disciples asked Jesus, "Teach us to pray." In John 17, our text for this morning, we get to hear another one of Jesus' prayers. But this time he's talking very intimately with the Father right on the eve of his death. He entrusts himself, his very life, to God. And he entrusts everyone he cares about, all the believers, to God too. And that includes us. I invite you to listen to the Lord's other prayer and think about what was on Jesus' heart and how God is answering his prayer in our lives. Ronan's going to read John 17.
After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, that only true God and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine, and glory has come to me through them. I will remain in this world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by that name you gave me. None has been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that scripture will be fulfilled. I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take care of them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them to the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just like you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you have sent me and loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am, and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them.
Thanks, Ronan. So in the beginning of Jesus' prayer, he uses the word glory and glorify several times. These are from the Greek word doxazo, which means to honor and recognize the value of someone, to acknowledge their true character and identity and their worth. Jesus has accomplished his mission so that people know who God is, his true character, his identity. I often speak about it as Jesus is the one who showed us God's heart. He has opened the way to eternal life, which essentially is knowing the one true God. And now it is time to be released, to be free on God's side in heaven. He will enjoy the glory that he had before he ever came as baby Jesus to the earth. And since he won't be in the world anymore, Jesus has some very specific things on his heart that he wants God to do to fulfill the promises he's made to the believers and to take care of them. The very first thing I notice is that he would like God to bless us with protection. And that's something we often ask and pray for. In verse 11, it says, "Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one." God the Father revealed his identity when he told the children of Israel, "I am." He is the one who is, was, and is to come. And then if we think about the name of Jesus, that means God is salvation. So these are powerful names that hold all of eternity, all of what we need in these names, because they reflect their character, who they are, what they're about, their mission. And we can call on the name of God. We can call on the name of Jesus when we need protection, because it's in their nature to protect those that they love, and they love you. Now, this doesn't mean that we won't ever face difficulties in our lives, but God is present, giving us strength and helping us to do whatever is best. So a little bit earlier this week, on Tuesday, I went to the rec park as I often do. I was planning to do a walk, jog, pray kind of thing. And I had a rock in my shoe, so I leaned against the ball fence that's covered in these yellow tubing things so no one will get hurt. But I leaned right where there was a yellow jacket nest, and they all came around and started stinging me, and I was like, ah, and I was hitting them off of myself furiously, and I just started running home because I could feel that they had stung me a lot. And I was most certainly calling to God for help because I wasn't really sure if it would cause some really bad allergic reaction to have all these stings. And God did help me. He provided Matthew being at home instead of at work in Rutland. And I had lost my glasses in all the flurry of activity. So I couldn't even see like what medication was. So he was like looking in the drawer and putting the right ointments on all my stings. And he went to the drugstore and could read the labels and get me some antihistamine. And then we went back to the park together when things had settled down a little bit to look for my glasses, and we couldn't find them. And I was praying, "Lord, if they're here, can you just, you know, can you help me?" I had wandered into the tall grass, so we were looking all through that, and no glasses. So I was like, "Lord, you know, I'm just gonna leave it in your hands. Help me know what to do next, because I can't see to even do my work, prepare, you know, read things for the sermon and all of that." So I left my name and a description of the glasses and my phone number at the office, just in case anyone turned them in. And even within a couple of hours, someone had turned them in. And they were good as new. They're on my face right now, not even broken or scratched. So, you know, even though I wish I didn't receive the trouble of the stings and all the itching that has since happened to me all week long, I'm grateful that I wasn't allergic to the stings, it wasn't life-threatening for me, and that God provided help, and he even gave me my glasses back. And it's a small thing, but I'm wondering if you can think of a time when God has protected you in a difficult situation. Does anything come to mind for you? You know, the disciples that heard Jesus' original prayer, they faced trouble too, but they didn't do it alone. They experienced God's protection along the way. In fact, the verse that comes right before this, Jesus says, "In this world you will have trouble, but don't be afraid, for I have overcome the world." That's what we were just singing about. They would have experienced the kind of protection that Jesus had experienced during his life and ministry. Do you remember how many times there were people who got angry with what Jesus was saying and they wanted to kill him right then and there? But Jesus just walked right through the crowd because it was not his time. That's the kind of protection God was giving him. Not so that he went up to heaven without ever experiencing a scratch. He experienced much more than that for us. But he was in the center of God's will, and God was protecting him to accomplish that will. The disciples, like Peter in this picture, were arrested by authorities for sharing the good news about salvation through Jesus. You know, right before this happened and he was arrested, the disciple named James was killed, and the authorities saw that pleased some of the people, so Peter was going to be next. Well, in Acts 12, we read about how the church was earnestly praying for protection for Peter, and God answered their prayers by sending an angel in the night, causing the chains to fall right off of Peter's wrists, even though he was chained to guards. And he miraculously swung the doors open, let him walk right out without anybody even waking up or noticing. And Peter, for his part, thought it was all a dream. But then he realized, no, it's real. So he's like, okay, now what do I do? And he decided to go to his friend's house where they were praying for him. And he knocks at the door, and the servant girl comes, and she's like, oh, I recognize his voice. It's Peter. And she goes to tell all the people praying, and they're like, no, it must be a ghost. You're mistaken. And it takes them a while to even let Peter in. But God had protected him. His life mission was not finished yet. God had more for him to do. If you are still here, and I assume that you are because I see you, that means that God has more for you to do. Have you ever thought about that? There's something special that you're meant to be doing at every phase of your life. And I hope that you really search God's heart and say, what is it? What is it that you want me here for? To accomplish for your glory before you take me home to heaven. Well, the second thing I noticed that Jesus prayed for the disciples and for all of us is sanctification. Do you know what sanctification is? It's not a word we use very often, but Ronan read it pretty many times this morning. The Greek word is hagazio, and it means to set apart as holy, as sacred. Does it remind you of sanctuary, where you're sitting right now? This space is set aside for a sacred purpose. We don't just do anything in here. It's meant and built and created so that we can worship God here, that we can hear the word, that we meet with God here. And sanctifying our life means that we live according to our sacred purpose. We know what it is. We're set apart. I'd like to read it, the same verses that Ronan read that said sanctify in the Passion Translation. It kind of spells it out for you, the meaning of sanctify. Verses 17 to 19. Your word is truth, so make them holy by the truth. I have commissioned them to represent me just as you commissioned me to represent you. And now I dedicate myself to them as a holy sacrifice so that they will live as fully dedicated to God and be made holy by your truth. The middle is the part that shows us our overall life purpose is to represent Jesus, to help people know God's heart just like he did. That's what we're here for. And we do that in unique ways that God lays on our heart and the Spirit enables us to do. But we're here to let people know that Jesus came to bring eternal life, the relationship with God that begins here and never ends. And in order to represent God and Jesus well, we're going to need time in the Word to know who they are. That's why we open the scriptures here every Sunday, so we can know God's character, his heart, and his will. But this is just 1 hour out of a week. That's 168 hours. I hope that you take some of those other hours and get into the Word and meet God and get to know his character so that you can represent him well. Because what we pay attention to shapes our thoughts and our actions. And our words and our actions are shaping what people think God is like. Jesus asked God to be the one to sanctify us because we can't make ourselves holy any more than a lump of clay can make itself into a useful jar. But if we are willing to spend time on a potter's wheel, God let him shape us with his word, yielding to that influence as we get to know him and become more like him, we'll become like a holy vessel for God's truth and we'll be able to share it with other people. How many of you like to read the Daily Bread devotionals? We give them out in the back. Well, there was one, you've already heard the story then, but I thought it was really appropriate to the sanctification example. It was, I think on Friday, the story was about a man named Jose Alberto Gutierrez who lives in Bogota, Colombia. And his job is to collect trash. And he lives in a modest little house in the town. But inside of his house is a treasure, more than 25,000 books he's rescued from being discarded. And he collects them, lines his house with them, and lets all the poor children in his neighborhood come and choose books to read. He turns his house into a free library on the weekends. The writer of the devotional for the Daily Bread, Patricia Raybon, said, "The same is true for every follower of Christ. We're made of humble clay, marred by cracks, easily broken, but we're entrusted by God as a home for his empowering spirit, who enables us to carry the good news of Christ into a hurting and broken world. We are not perfect. That's not what holy means. Holy means that we have a sacred purpose, that we are carrying something that's a treasure inside of us, the truth, the Spirit of God." 2 Corinthians 4:6-7 says it this way, "For God who said, let light shine out of darkness, made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God, not from us." The light of God is inside of you. It's his glory that he shares with us, not to draw attention to us, but that so people can get to know him and the light can spread into their lives. It's fun to be a person who's all lit up and shining with God's glory. And it's really fun to be around other people who are lit up too. When I say that, are there anyone you can think of that you feel is just kind of lit up with the treasure of that glory? I hope that maybe someone that you think is lit up is sitting nearby you and you enjoy gathering with them to worship or getting together with them in any context because you know you're going to see Jesus in them. And this helps us to be one with each other, which is Jesus' final request, unity. Verses 20 to 23, Jesus said, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message." That's us. and all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. The Greek word here is heis, one. It goes all the way back to the beginning, the Shema that the Hebrew people still say. It's from Deuteronomy 6:4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Yet we understand God to be in Trinity. That means they're a community of the Godhead, and yet they are one. They are united in close, loving relationship. And that's what Jesus wants us to be like, to have Jesus in us and God in us, the glory, the identity, the character glowing out of us. This doesn't mean that we're all going to be clones of each other. We all have to dress the same and do our hair the same and speak the same, because God obviously made us all very unique, and he likes that about us. But what it does mean is that God's character illuminates our character. They work together beautifully to be a piece that displays his glory. It'll still be recognizable as Jesus in us by the other believers, because they'll sense that the motivation for what we do and say is love of God. Becoming who we are meant to be in Jesus is a lifelong process, and it's done in relationship with God and each other in community. Jesus finishes his prayer to God the Father by saying, I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known, in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. We never get to the bottom of knowing about who God is. There's always more to know, to learn, as we draw closer and are shaped more and more by him. Do you see Jesus in each other? It's the most important element to having unity, because if we can see Jesus in each other, we can love Jesus in each other. And the things that might typically divide us, anything that divides people, personality, what we like to do, what we look like, how old we are, how rich or poor we are, how educated we are, those things don't have to matter at all. What matters is that Jesus is in us, and we can love that about each other. And it'll smooth over any differences that might otherwise ruffle each other's feathers. I saw a beautiful example of that, and some of you were there with me when we had our church picnic at the Horseshoe Acres campground. Ann and Gerald invited our church and put this poster up, and they just were so excited for us to come at no cost to us. They set aside all these tents and put them up for us, and tables, and put our name on there like we were the honored guests for no other reason than that they thought we loved Jesus. And they did so many things to help us feel welcome. They provided beverages and desserts. They gave people rides in their golf carts all over the campground just for nice. They took time to talk with us. And they even did this. They printed up t-shirts for the occasion. They wanted us to be there to hear the Middle River Gospel Band. But I was struck with what the t-shirt said. It has all these descriptions about Christ that kind of make a big world. And it says, Jesus Christ, what we have in common. I could see Jesus in them. It flowed out of them in love and joy. They were lit up kind of people with God's glory. And they were looking for Jesus in us and wanting to share the glory of Jesus with anyone who would come and be attracted to that space and hear about Jesus that night. Can we be like that all the time? Would you like to be like that? I came across a description, another image maybe you can take with you. It's an excerpt from a theology professor named Dr. Diana L. Hayes, her book, No Crystal Stair. And I thought it was a beautiful expression of the unity that Jesus asked God to sustain in us. The image is a river. We are not alone in this world, nor have we ever been, no matter how much we may feel otherwise. Many have come before us and will come after us, feeling the same way, seeking as we are for the light. And it is in coming together, one by one, two by two, and on, that we form the converging tributaries that make up the mighty stream of just and righteous people flowing home to God. We are and can be the justice that rolls down like water, the righteousness that flows like a mighty stream. This is our calling as Christian faithful, to recognize the Christ in each other, to reach out a hand of hope, to speak a word of love, to sing a song of happiness, or share a tear of joy or pain, to speak a word of praise, to murmur a prayer, to stand together against the forces that would divide us, isolate us, and block our flow toward home. Jesus laid down his life for us, living out his holy purpose to the end. And as we remember his sacrifice and the love that compelled him, may we also remember the desires that Jesus lifted up on the eve of his death in this prayer. God is willing and able to answer these requests for our protection, our sanctification, and our unity. But God never forces gifts upon us. We need to have an open heart to receive them. So are our hearts open this morning? Would you pray with me? Dear Jesus, thank you for praying for us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for giving your life, laying it down for us, that we can have this beautiful connection with you that begins here in this troubled world and will continue and grow in intensity forever, for eternity. Lord, help it to shape our lives, to give us purpose, to light us up, to bring you glory, and may others come to know you and become part of the river that flows toward home. In Jesus' name, amen.
Trampled on the ground, you took
the fall and thought of me above all.
Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord that which I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is for you. Eat this as often as you do in remembrance of me."
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, O Lord, have mercy on me. Let us drink wine together on our knees. Let us drink wine together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me. Let us praise God together on our knees. Let us praise God together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me.
Love us, and you invite us to return your love. Help us never to doubt your care for us. Help us to see your presence amidst our trials and troubles. And may you be able to use our lives to bring you glory, to light the way for others to know you. In Jesus' name, amen. In a moment, we'll have a time of fellowship. I hope you'll be able to stay for refreshments and sharing with one another, but receive the benediction before you go. Would you like to stand? May we come to know God better each day, and may God's